The mellow sounds of Iruma's piano music are familiar to most of us and have moved us in different ways. The South Korean-British composer and pianist's best-loved compositions, River Flows in You, Maybe, and Kiss the Rain, they've become classics as the simple yet beautiful melodies make us daydream of a sunny afternoon and can bring us calm and restoration at times we need it most. Especially over the course of this pandemic, Iruma's music has been a source of healing for many people around the world. And last year, Iruma rose to the top of the Billboard Classical Album chart, ranking number one for over 20 weeks, indicating just how popular his music has been and globally loved throughout the years. In fact, this year marks his 20th year of debut, and today we speak to him on Global Insight. Welcome to the show, Mr. Lee. How are you today?
Hello, thank you for inviting me. Well, yes, it's good to see you, yes.
Yeah, thank you for coming on the show. And actually, today on Friday, you're releasing a single to mark World Sleep Day. It's called Nocturnal Mind, I believe. And I think we can have an exclusive first listen on the day of its release today. And so let's just go and do just that. Let's take a listen. And to our viewers, please do note that the video is a compilation of past clips and not the actual music video. Well, we couldn't hear all of it, of course, but it's beautiful. And well, we can listen to you can listen to more of it if you purchase this song, which is available today. But Mr. Lee, can you tell us more about this song and why this day, a day to highlight the importance of sleep? Why is this significant for all of us?
Well, I mean, it is essential to have a good rest, you know, have a good quality sleep for everyone. I mean, well, I thought it would be quite good to introduce, and it's a good time to introduce my own music. As you mentioned it, the song called Nocturnal Mind. And it is quite, it would help people to, you know, help them to sleep well. Well, it is to mark World Sleep Day also, and to make people realize that how important to, you know, have a good night's sleep. Yeah, that's it.
Even I think that was about 30 seconds of it, but it just puts your mind at ease and it's very soothing. So I think it would definitely put me to sleep and also just get me into the relaxation mode that you need to actually fall asleep. So, yeah, I mean, World Sleep Day, that's today, Friday. So, yeah, hopefully the message will spread throughout the world. And, well, your album, your new album, The Rewritten Memories, that marks your 20th year of debut since you rose to the global stage. First of all, big congratulations. And this is actually your first album that you did with an orchestra. And your latest pieces, of course, Room with a View and Sunset Bed. What inspired these songs?
Well, all the surroundings that I can, you know, see of. I mean, the Room with a View, I mean, basically, I wrote this song when I went to the Italy, the southern part of Italy, named Martina Franca. It was a beautiful place, and I went there like 2 years ago, middle of summer. And the place I stayed was so beautiful, the blue sky, the olive trees, you know, everywhere. The green, the blue sky, everything was so soothing and so beautiful. And that just, you know, struck me, you know, to come up with the melody. And yeah, that's why I named it Room with a View. And the sunset bird also, I mean, it's a view from, you know, the view that you see through the window, you know. Every time I, you know, not getting any ideas, I try to just see the view that I can find. Just like, you know, the views, the sceneries that, you know, the birds, you know, just flying off on the sunset. You know, it's something that you see every day. And all the inspirations are from, you know, all the surroundings I can, you know, I can see, you know, that's the most inspiration that I get all the time when I write music.
I think that really, even the title, it just sort of captures how your music really resonates with everyone and anyone. Because a room with you, everyone has that, but like your music, it really impacts you or hits you in very different ways. And your music has always been described as very healing, and it's indeed touched many people's lives. How do you make your music speak to so many people around the world?
Well, in my opinion, I try to think of like simplistic forms of like chord progressions or the melody lines, and I mean, that's why the people are finding easier to listen to and understand straight, you know, without any, you know, difficulties. You can just understand when you hear it at first. And well, because of that, I mean, most of the pieces are very, you know, enjoyable to perform. So that's why people are trying to, you know, just try out on their keyboard, the piano they have at home. So I mean, that's why people, you know, like to find my music a lot to listen. Yes.
And well, because you bring so many people healing, I'm curious, how do you find your own moments of healing, especially during this pandemic?
Well, spending time with my families, I mean, that is most the healing time at the moment, that I can think of right now. Well, watching films, reading books that I haven't read it. Just that's it. I mean, there aren't much many things you can do right now, I mean, because of the situation. So I try to find something that makes me really, you know, enjoyable to do. And I love making things. Like I love making like plastic models and all that. I like building them and paint them. You know, as you can see on the back, there's a table, there's a desk with you know, all the tools, you know, for plastic models. So yeah, I do that all the time, you know.
Do you do anything that might surprise us all, like maybe listen to very heavy metal rock or something like
I mean,
that?
of course, I mean, because I'm a musician, I do listen to a lot of Brit rocks and like some of the, you know, most popular bands like Travis, and I don't know, I mean, any kind of genres. I mean, I really love to, you know, listen to when I have a free time. Yes.
See, well, marking your 20th year of debut, what do you think has really changed you as a composer and a performer over the years?
Well, to be honest, I haven't changed at all, really. I mean, I always think of myself as a, you know, the same person as I was 20 years ago. And now I still trying to write something new. You know, I try to create something that I haven't had a chance to, you know, just, you know, explore around. So I don't think I have been changed at all, really. Yeah, everything is the same. I mean, as a musician, yes, I'm the person as I was, yes.
Well, unfortunately, due to the pandemic circumstances, you have had to take your concerts online. And well, did you have a sort of routine when you were preparing for offline concerts before the pandemic? And what kind of changes did you have to make to that? And What were the hardest things to have to get used to when preparing for an online concert?
Is to get the right audio, the sound of the quality of the sound, really, because the people are watching me and listening through the internet, and so it is really important to have a good sound quality. So that was the most important part of it. But you know, when you're doing the offline concert, when you're on the stage, I mean, all the sound equipments are, you know, is already there. I mean, so I mean, there aren't much to do. But yeah, for online, I mean, there are many things that you have to, you know, prepare, such as the audio, the quality of the audio.
Of course, and you want to make it sound as, you know, you want to optimize it as much as possible. And I can imagine how, well, stressful that must be as a musician. And actually, one of the most special things about your offline live music was the way you really interacted with the audience. I mean, showing your inspiration and also improvising and encouraging them to really, as you once said, insert their own memories into the music. So how was it for you having to adjust to this no audience setting?
Well, first of all, I mean, there are no people, well, there aren't any people cheering, you know, like applause, and nothing's there. So it is very awkward to just you know, by yourself, just playing on the piano. It is very it is weird to play without the audience. But I tried to like hypnotize myself, kind of. Just there are, you know, audience right in front of me, you know, and trying to perform as I do on the stage, you know, when I do the offline concert. And yeah, I mean, most of the time I improvise a lot. I mean, the piece that you have been listening on the recording, by the recording, I mean, it's all different. And when I perform, I try to play differently every time, and I try not to think of the recordings I've done. So I try to play differently, and sometimes I like pick one person from the audience and I invite him or her to just play with me. And we play like four hands together. It's all improvised, and it's kind of fun to interact with the audience. So I do that all the time when I do the concert.
Really, what's so special about your music is that a lot of people love playing it themselves, however, whatever style that may be. And you're also open to experimenting with various types of music, including with K-pop artists who you've been working with in recent years. Just wondering, what are some of your favorite K-pop songs right now?
Oh, it is very hard to choose, really. I mean, I like most of the K-pops. I love to listen like Lehi and Shiny. I did work with them, and they are just great. And yeah, I mean, I have to, you know, go with the trend. Yeah, of course. I love BTS also. Yes, of course. And yeah, I mean, I love to listen to any of K-pop. Yes, artists' works. So yeah, I don't think it's right to say just few people, but yeah, I did that.
It's always tough to choose. And well, now going forward, what do you hope to do over the next 10 years until 2031, which is when you'll mark your 30th anniversary?
Well, I never thought of what, you know, after what would happen to me after 10 years. I'll be, you know, just writing music. I mean, that's all I wanted to do. The final wish, the goal that I would say would be, you know, establishing a music school of mine, just to teach someone, you know, just to share what I have to share my knowledge that I have learned for last, 20 years. So it would be quite great to, achieve that goal, really. Like my name, Iruma, that's the meaning, achieve your goal.
And well, you said that
Well,
you
you said
haven't
that
changed over the last 20 years as a composer and a pianist, and hopefully this will remain the same over the next 10 years as well, just continuing unchanging in the way you really bring hope and peace to people's hearts and with the beautiful, simple but very evocative music that you make. Well, this is
thanks.
where we'll end the interview today, but thank you so much for your time. That was South Korean British composer and pianist Iruma. Again, thank you very much, and for adding all this warmth and calm and inspiration to our lives at a time when we need it most.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
And to our viewers, as always, thank you for watching.